Welcome to All Things Financial with Jack Driscoll. Each week, Jack takes on all things you thought were hard to understand about your finances and makes it fun, easy, but most of all, interesting. From insurance to the best way to save your money and squeeze the most out of the dollars you put aside for your rainy day. And now, you have a friend in the money business. Here's your host, Jack Driscoll.
Welcome back again, everyone, to another edition of All Things Financial. Last week, I had a special guest on, and he's agreed to come back. Greg Felton from NSS Life. Thanks for coming back.
Thank you, Jack.
If you could tell everyone a little bit about you and NSS Life also, and how to contact you if they have any questions on anything they hear and see on the show, I'd appreciate that.
Glad to do it. I work for NSS Life. It is a fraternal insurance organization. We're based in McMurray, PA. My email address is gfelton, F-E-L-T-O-N, at nsslife.org. And our telephone number there is 724-731-0094.
And tell me a little bit about what you do with NSS Life and what you do for the community and the families you serve.
Well, NSS Life's been around for 126 years. We are a community-oriented organization. I'm the national sales director, so I try to do all of the sales, marketing, advertising. Some of those areas are my responsibilities. But we are active in the community. We have a lot of local chapters that do good work, you know, from food banks to working with churches, cleanups in communities.
So we
try to give back as much as possible.
That's good.
Absolutely.
Yeah, I've seen the name around enough to know and worked with you long enough to know very community-oriented.
Absolutely.
And family-oriented.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Hey, folks, what we did last week, we talked about life insurance because next month in September, as you pointed out, is Life Insurance Awareness Month. And it continued into a conversation that Greg and I wanted to have today. And you might go into some of the topics we might want to talk about today.
I'll be glad to. One of the things we touched on last week was annuities. And these are a hot topic. You hear a lot about them. I mean, there's a lot of advantages to annuities. And I'd just like to touch on a few of the key points. One is usually you get a nice competitive rate of interest on an annuity. It always has a guaranteed rate in it. They are tax deferred, which is one of the big advantages. Probate free, which means as long as the proceeds are paid to a beneficiary, the money passes outside of your will, so to speak. It goes right by contract law to the named beneficiary.
When you talk annuity, I think some people might not even know really what an annuity is. And I'll tell you why I say that. I got into the business in 1976, and I had trouble with the feeling that annuities were complicated or beyond me until probably 12 or 14 years in the business when I finally said, okay, listen, you need to figure these things out. Can you explain a little bit about the basics of what an annuity really is?
Sure can. An annuity is basically a savings account offered by insurance companies. That's the simplest explanation. The word annuity it's a complicated word itself, and so sometimes I think that adds to the confusion. But they're really just savings accounts offered by insurance companies. They have a couple little twists to them. One is that they're backed by the full faith and credit of the insurance company.
Okay. As opposed to the FDIC.
Correct.
With the banks.
Correct. And they're tax deferred. So that's a big plus. You don't pay taxes on annuities until you withdraw the money. Now there's three different types of annuities. There are fixed annuities, variable annuities, indexed annuities. Fixed annuities are kind of like the ones that NSS does. So I'm very familiar with those.
Okay.
And that rate is determined by the organization. It's a set rate. They usually pay that rate. I mean, it can change over time, but it's more of a portfolio rate of interest. A variable annuity is usually tied to some stock market fund. It could be a mutual fund, a stock fund, a bond fund, and your proceeds may rise or fall with that fund.
Yeah, and I know a lot of those are based on an index.
Correct. Yeah. And then the indexed annuities are based on a true index. And they have some limits and conditions associated with them. They're all good. They all have their places and purposes. I think the most important thing is for people to make sure you understand what you're getting.
So you have a fixed annuity, fixed traditional annuity like you in NSS provide.
Yes.
You have the what they would call a variable annuity, which is based on more like sub-accounts similar to mutual fund type accounts.
Correct.
And then you have the fixed or indexed, fixed indexed annuity that is based on maybe stock or bond market indexes.
Correct.
And you mean in all of those cases, the returns and performance are based on those. That sound right?
Yes.
Okay. And the ones that you offer are the fixed traditional. Explain to me a little bit about when you said competitive interest rates.
Well, if usually, I mean, a lot of money that comes to annuities comes through retirement plans or maybe savings accounts at the bank. And as you know, the bank rates currently are very low. Well, in comparison, you probably could get 3% or more at on a fixed annuity.
Today.
Today, right now, which is pretty good.
Yeah, this is August 2016 when we're at near zero rates, when 3% sounds so good.
Absolutely.
And 10 years ago, we were at much higher rates, and we would not have liked 3%. But tell me, though, was NSS 3% then?
10 years ago?
Right.
Oh, no, no. It was much higher.
Because what I have found is with NSS and some other companies, your interest rates where you said they can change or they're portfolio-based, when I think traditional fixed annuity, I think locked-in interest rate for the length of term in that annuity. Because normal fixed traditional annuities, if it's a 3% rate and it's an 8-year product, it's 3% maximum for the whole 8 years. But that's not necessarily the case with NSS Life, is it?
That's correct. Not with us. But there are companies that offer those fixed rate annuities for periods of time or length of term, like 3 years, 5 years, 8 years, for example. So yes, it is possible to get those.
Now, when you see, if we would see a change in interest rates or the inflation environment or whatever, is it possible that you would have a fluctuation or an upward increase or a downward increase if rates went down? So you're not necessarily locked in for that whole length of time.
Correct.
Okay.
Yes.
So there can be a potential advantage with us, not necessarily, but a potential advantage with us in low inflationary times where the pressure might be, you're not stuck with a low interest rate if rates go through the roof like they did in the 70s.
Right.
Okay.
Yes.
Tell me a little bit about when somebody looks at an annuity, what, who it is that typically looks at these annuities and why?
It seems that we get most of our annuity business from retirees or near retirees.
Okay.
And maybe it's because of the safety of annuities that they're considering that. You know, they don't want to, there's a lot of people who are maybe leaving the market, so they're looking for that safety factor. But that's generally the average age of a purchaser is probably around 55 years old. Average amount deposited is somewhere around $40,000. Doesn't have to be. It can be $1,000. It can be $100,000.
Okay.
But, yeah. But that's just the averages.
Okay. Now, you mentioned that the annuities are tax deferred.
Correct. That's a very strong point. What it really means is with annuities, the money you deposit is considered your principal. So for example, if you put in $10,000 and you left the money there for a couple of years, and now your account was worth $15,000 and you were withdrawing some money, you would only owe tax on that $5,000 of gain. That's considered the interest.
Okay.
And on annuities, it's always interest out first. That's when the government has their chance to collect their tax money. So they want that interest comes out first. And then the other $10,000 that would come back to you if you took all the money out is a return of principal.
Okay.
As opposed to like IRAs, you know, we do have a lot of people who use annuities for IRA accounts. Everything you withdraw from an IRA is taxable.
Okay.
Principal and interest because you received a tax deduction or should have.
So in spite of the normal benefits with an annuity, that's interesting to point out. If you do that inside an IRA, the IRA rules apply no matter what
Correct.
Okay, was purchased with it.
Correct.
We talked about, when we get into this annuities, you mentioned these avoid probate or can if they're made payable to a named beneficiary. Can you explain that and also why that would be an advantage?
It is a big advantage because here's what happens. You name a beneficiary. You can name a contingent beneficiary. You can name a tertiary beneficiary. That's going down three levels. But if the money or proceeds are paid to a named beneficiary, they pass by contract law, because an annuity is a contract between you and the insurance company.
Okay.
So it passes directly to that person that you named as your beneficiary. So for instance, I have three children. If I listed one child as my beneficiary on my annuity, that child's going to get that money. Won't make the other two happy, but that's just the way it works. Now there are certain situations where that comes in. It's a very useful point when you're planning how your proceeds are going to be distributed. You know, we may leave one child a house, so you'll leave this child the annuity, and you know, you can work this all out. But as long as you have a plan, that's the important part. If you inadvertently leave people off, that's when it's a problem.
Well, let's talk about that now. I thought a will, or a lot of people might think that a will would take care of all that, even if you made a mistake on your beneficiaries inside the annuity.
Well, a will take care of the balance of your estate that does not pass by law. So for instance, if you and your spouse own your house, obviously, and something happens to you, your spouse now owns the house. It's not going to go into the will. If you had an annuity, it's going to pass by contract law to that named beneficiary. Let's just say that beneficiary was a child. It passes to them. Now the rest of your estate, if it was just something that you owned, maybe some stocks, bonds, other assets, they could pass through your estate and be subject to the will, and then whatever you wrote in your will, it'll be divided up that way.
So if someone, let's say, through a life change, makes sure to go out and changes their will so they have everything taken care of, what you're pointing out is, wait a minute, you might not have everything taken care of because a will doesn't preside over these contracts.
Correct.
So if you left an old whatever on this annuity as a beneficiary.
We see it all the time at our office. We see ex-spouses. I mean, people do die, get divorced, things happen. So we have the former spouse on as the beneficiary. That's always a problem.
Mm-hmm.
We have one child or two children when there were three.
Ah. So they'll make all their beneficiaries when they have two children forget after they have a third child to change anything, think they have all their children, not thinking.
Correct.
Oh my goodness.
Yes. and I mean, it's not anything deliberate. Sometimes just accidentally forgot to do this. So that's why last week, you know, we talked a little bit about the importance of a policy review.
Again,
even with annuities and IRAs, it's very important to once a year, you should sit down, check those, make sure they're correct. Because also your beneficiaries get married, so you want to have correct names on there. It creates a little less paperwork later on.
And then I guess the person that does all these, when they're reviewing all their wills and other legal documents, you get to the point where you say you review these too, but who can change these beneficiaries?
Any policyholder can change their beneficiary as long as they're the annuitant and the owner of their contract.
Okay.
There is two little steps.
Do they have to be the annuitant?
Which normally, I hesitate here only because normally the annuitant and the owner of the contract are one and the same person, probably 90% of the time. But once in a while, we might have an annuitant who has the annuity contract that may be a child and their parent is the owner.
Ah, I see.
So in that case, the owner has to sign, but that's the only difference.
Okay, got it.
But for the most part, yes, an annuitant or the owner of their contract can change the beneficiary. The forms are always online at any company, probably. Print off the form, change the beneficiary, and it's immediately fixed.
So what happens when the owner or annuitant, the owner gets too old to have the mental faculties, let's say, to be able to control their affairs?
Excellent.
What happens?
Excellent question, and we see that also. A lot of times you've heard of power of attorney.
Yes.
These are something that your local attorney will draw up for you so that you can take care of mom and dad's estate or take care of their affairs. Right. Well, recently in Pennsylvania, in fact, it was in January of 15, Pennsylvania passed a law that specifically says that power of attorneys, and we have these all the time coming to our office, but specifically since January 15, the power of attorney must have a change of beneficiary provision in that power of attorney.
Really?
That specifically allows the power of attorney to change the beneficiary.
So you're telling me what we were taught before, you ask your attorney and the attorneys recommend this general durable power of attorney, which was the, you could do all power of attorney, and you're saying as of January what?
15.
This year?
January 15.
That after that point, a general durable power of attorney or whatever that used to work for, let's quote unquote, everything, now if you want to be able to use it to make beneficiary changes, that old power of attorney needs amended and new powers of attorney have to specify that too?
Correct. That's exactly right.
I did not know that.
Apparently, sometimes, you know, a person that has the power of attorney might be changing the beneficiaries to suit themselves, and it may be to the detriment of some other family members. So I guess this has happened, and this is one of the reasons for this change. So now the person has to be fully aware that this power of attorney, even though this is their trusted advisor,
they want to make sure
even if they change the beneficiary.
You don't mean to tell me that someone actually, when they got older and less competent or incompetent, that a power of attorney or a trusted someone, representative, would actually come in and change the beneficiary to themselves.
That's probably happened. Let's just say that's probably happened.
Oh, boy. Never goes away. I mean, is there anything else that you want to cover on this? I have a couple questions here when we get into the annuity side, but is there anything you want to touch on before I get into these questions?
No, absolutely. Go ahead. Ask away.
First question I have is, I understand with annuities, one of the reasons their interest is accumulated tax deferred inside the annuity is because the IRS sees those as somewhat retirement-oriented vehicles, even though they're not a qualified plan. Is that correct?
Absolutely, that is correct. The original goal of annuities was to help people save money for retirement. And that's why there's a couple little stipulations in there. Usually, if you're withdrawing money from an annuity, you have to be at least 59 and a half to avoid a 10% penalty. You can take the money out prior to 59 and a half, but there's a 10% penalty in addition to paying tax on the interest.
So what happens then is, even though you're in an annuity which is not in a qualified plan, so you use your own money, you've already paid tax on, it's not an IRA, you're just putting money in this savings account, so to speak, with the insurance company, but you are handcuffed somewhat on any of the interest that was deferred or earned.
Correct.
That if you withdraw your money from that annuity savings account, as you call it, and decide to do anything else with it, but you decide to withdraw it, that you are subject then to some IRS excise tax penalty in addition to whatever the income tax would have been on those earnings?
Correct.
Okay, that's an interesting one, so everybody needs to be aware of
absolutely.
That.
Absolutely, absolutely. And that's to encourage the long-term savings aspect.
Now, I've also heard annuities can sometimes be advantageous to people in retirement on Social Security.
Yes.
Can you explain some of the reasons people are saying that?
Yes. What happens with annuities, if you're earning interest, let's say that you were earning interest and it was X amount of money and you had the money in the bank, you're going to get at the end of the year a 1099 from the bank for that interest earnings. That interest gets added to your income tax, and that number might push you over the threshold for certain Social Security taxation levels.
Okay, I see. So if they're close on the bracket there, you might say if you're in an annuity, if you're in a CD, earning the same interest theoretically, your taxes might look different that year.
Yes.
Whether you're taking the money out or not taking the money out matters in that case possibly.
Correct. Because the CD is going to generate that 1099, whereas the annuity is going to be tax deferred if you're leaving the money in there.
So the interest doesn't show up on that tax year necessarily. So if you're right on the border, $44,000, you know how when Social Security is, Social Security when you're in retirement, your checks might be taxed, they might not be taxed. And in that calculation, if they are taxed, then it might be up to 50% or 85%. You're saying you could check your tax bracket and see if you're right on the border there, you might want to have some deferred income that you don't need because it doesn't show up on the tax return since it's deferred.
Absolutely.
Keeps you under that
yes.
85% bracket. Okay, that's an interesting strategy.
That's a good little strategy to keep
like
in mind.
That. I like that.
Yes.
Okay.
Another thing that you mentioned since we talked a little bit about retirees is another little variation with annuities, and it's called a single premium immediate annuity.
Okay.
And you can actually utilize this provision in any other annuity contract, but somewhere along the way, when you get to a certain point in life, like maybe I'm just using this as an example, age 75, you have X amount of money in your annuity account, and you decide, you know what I really need? I don't need that lump sum of money. I need monthly income for the rest of my life. Well, only an annuity can provide it because insurance companies use actuarial studies and mortality studies, and they determine that a person 75 years old, if they retire, they should be able to live at least to another 9 or 10 years,
okay.
So to age 85. So they will figure out examples of how much money they can pay you per month based on that block of funds.
Okay.
Then they start to do that, but they can do it for the rest of your life. And that's the beauty of it because we don't know how long we're going to live.
Yeah.
We all hope to live a long, fruitful life and have our faculties and enjoy good health. And maybe we will live to be age 100.
Yeah.
But if you do and you have that annuity and you took the monthly income, you'll still get a check.
Wow.
So that's
okay.
That's a big plus.
Yeah, that's a big plus. Let's go in reverse. Because we're talking about these as somewhat, they're not retirement plans, but they are subject to that IRS pre-59 and a half. If you pull your money out prior to 59 and a half, similar regulation as what is on an IRA, let's say for a penalty purpose. What about the 70 and a half rule that if money is not pulled out and it's non-qualified, it's just a savings account annuity, it's not a qualified IRA or anything like that. Do you have to start taking money out of these?
You do not. The IRAs have that age 70 and a half where that required minimum distribution starts. But annuities, being non-qualified, do not have that rule. So you could accumulate the money past 70 and a half to 75 to 80. At 90 years old, you could still have the money in there earning interest.
So there are a lot of planning opportunities then that I can see where that annuities have features that most other alternatives, they're different than many other alternatives.
Yes.
So they might create special, unique planning opportunities exploiting some of those differences.
Correct.
Yeah, I like that a lot.
And that's why it's important for people to always talk with a qualified professional advisor, because that person hopefully will have a little bit of knowledge about the taxes, where they're at, planning opportunities, longevity planning.
Yeah.
All these things come into play.
And I think they need to tie this in, and everyone listening and watching, with a legal review at the same time, wouldn't you agree, as your insurance review and your retirement review, you kind of tie that all together. You get all the professionals working together there.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, again, if you could share, we're out of time, but share your contact information.
Absolutely. It's Greg Felton at gfelton@nsslife.org or 724-731-0094.
And listen, folks, anyone who wants information, further information on these annuities, or anything else that NSS provides, please feel free to contact Greg. He'll get you all taken care of. Greg, I appreciate your coming on the show again and simplifying a fairly complex, seemingly, area of annuities. I appreciate that very much.
Thank you, Jack.
Thanks. All right, folks, we'll be back again next week for another edition of All Things Financial. Thanks again for tuning in.
Securities and investment advisory services offered through Sage Point Financial Inc., member FINRA, SIPC, and registered investment advisor. Insurance services offered through Driscoll Insurance and Financial Services Inc., which is not affiliated with Sage Point Financial Inc.